perfectly love you and worthy, magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. chapter of Daniel. As I watched, thrones were set in place, and an ancient one took his throne. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair on his head was like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, and its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and flowed out from his presence. 1,000 thousands served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood attending him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were opened. As I watched in the night visions, I saw one like a human being covered with the clouds of heaven. And he came to the ancient one and was presented before him. To him was given dominion and glory and kingship, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not pass away, and his kingship is one that shall never be destroyed. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 93 responsively by whole verse. The Lord is King, robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and armed with strength.
The Lord has made the world so sure that it cannot be moved. Ever since the world began, your throne has been established. You are from everlasting.
The waters have lifted up, O Lord, the waters have lifted up their voice. The waters have lifted up their pounding waves.
Mightier than the sound of many waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea, mightier is the Lord who dwells on high.
Your testimonies are very sure, and holiness befits your house, O Lord, forever and forevermore.
Amen.
The second reading is taken from the first chapter of Revelation. Grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
John 18:33-36. Thomas entered the headquarters again. Some of the priests had asked, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Thomas replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests are handing you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But that as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the tells us that his throne is everlasting. And then in Revelation, he tells us that Jesus Christ is that person that we talked about today. He's the beginning and the end. The Gospel of John says Jesus came to testify to the truth. When I read these readings, the first one in Daniel, when they talk about a judge, I'm a lawyer, have been a lawyer for ever, it seems. And one of the things that, as a trial lawyer, that was difficult is when you're standing before the judge and you disagree with his understanding of the law, or you have disagreed with his interpretation of the facts. And the problem is, regardless of what you say, he has the ultimate decision to make, and will make it. It took me a long time to accept that. But the problem is, you have no choice other than go to jail. And a few times, I got reasonably close. But the fact is that that feeling of just not accepting what the judge says is the same feeling we as human beings have. Ever since Adam, you know, we want to go our own way. We don't accept what God tells us. We want to make our own laws. We're going to make our own interpretation. That's especially true today. More so than another time. This gospel also reminded me of a trip that I took north. And this is a picture. It's actually in the ark. This ark is the ark encounter is in Williamsburg, Kentucky. I used to live in Ohio, so it goes straight up to 75. And it is about a half a mile off of I-75 in Williamsburg. It has two things. One, it has a creation museum. And basically, what this man has done is built a museum and used God's words and put in different scenes, different words of God, and then argues why the Bible is correct and what it said about creation in 7 days. And it was really, it confirms what you have read in the Bible. The second place, this is one place. The other place is an ark, which is that picture of that. Now that ark is built about the same size, they think, as Noah's ark. And the ark is 510 feet long, 7 stories high. It is quite a sight to see, actually. This picture doesn't do it justice, but it's quite, I know some of you can't see it, but it's quite interesting how he did it. Inside, there are 7 floors that, and on each floor, it talks, well, it starts with creation, actually, and then works its way all the way to the top. And it has stairs that are ramps that go up and back. And what this does is it shows you how this could be. You know, the problem with the ark is that we've always put in a bathtub with giraffes sticking out of the top. We sort of made a joke, you know. Well, God didn't think it was a joke. And this makes you appreciate and understand how this could be. How it is not impossible, but in taking into consideration how they did things in the past, it makes a lot of sense. It makes sense. And they had strong storage bins for grain. They have stalls for different animals. And you look at it, you go, you know, that worked. A couple of interesting things I learned from it, though, was, number one, it took Noah 75 years to build the ark. He had built it for a while. And he didn't do it by himself. But the second thing was, you know, God said, two of every kind. That doesn't, you take a basic animal, and out of it came many different animals. So what I'm saying is, the thing you think makes sense is you take the basic kind, like a horse. Could be a donkey, could be a real thing. So that was interesting. And secondly, the idea that God, what would God put in there? God would put in there young animals. Full size giraffe. Logically, that doesn't make sense. And then, so the other thing was eggs for those animals. But the point is, the whole concept takes what you read in the Bible and you, it says, you know, he could do it. Of course, God can do it. But the point is, even in today's questioning attitude, it's surely impressive upon me, or impressed upon me, the story of Noah and the ark. And the thing, well, how did we get to the ark? Christ the King built to the ark. Well, you know, God made us. He created us. We didn't, mankind didn't do too well. And we ended up with a flood. Man didn't do too well. And where did we end up? God's plan was that Jesus would come and be our ark for the future. You know, I'm a chaplain at Southern Regional Office. And so I have people all the time ask me about Jesus. They just say, you know, tell me about him. Some do, some don't. But what I tell them is this. Jesus came into this world to tell us about the past, the present, and the future. God, Jesus came in to tell us about God. More about God. Who God is and what God's plan. He came and how to live. And Jesus came to tell us how, who our neighbor is. And what are we supposed to do with him? What's the plan of life? The purpose of life? Jesus came in to do these things. We tend to forget all that he did. Besides, and on top of that, of course, he had the 12 disciples. And the Holy Spirit, used to spread his word throughout the world. And of course, he came to suffer and die. And Jesus said that if we would confess our sin, accept him as Lord and Savior, believe that he died on the cross, believe that our sins are forgiven, then he'd forgive our sin. And he wouldn't remember them anymore. One of the things that I always thought about when I first see Jesus, I always think he's going to say two things. One, basically, why you worry so much? I tend to, you know, in life you tend to worry. And so the point is that Jesus came not just as a king. You know, we have a hard time with the issue of king. We don't have kings in this country. Of course, they have in the Old Testament. Some of the Europeans have kings, and most of them are ill thought of because they don't do a very good job. But we're not familiar with kings. I think Jesus is more than Christ the King. Jesus is everything. He made us. He loved us. He called us. He comes to us, and he forgave us. And he promises, I will come out and get you. That's what Jesus did. And that is so awesome. The other day, and what I have going from East Coast to Iowa, had a massive stroke and an aneurysm in the brain. He was with his younger daughter. They had an emergency land at Hartsfield and rushed him to Southern Regional. And he was there up to several days before I saw him. And the young daughter, when I walked in the room, the young daughter was, she has no people there. She had nowhere to stay. She has very little money. She and her father is dying in front of her. And I mention this because that's what Jesus is. You know, I talked to her about what Jesus is to me. And I said, you know, did he go to church? And she said, well, no, and I'm worried about that. And I said, well, before I could say anything else, she said, he worked 7 days a week. He was a Hispanic person. And he said he had five children. She said five siblings. And he worked to support them. And I said, well, and before I could say anything else, she said, but I want you to know, he loved Jesus. And I said, how do you know that? He said, she said, because he talked about him all the time. She said, Jesus was in his mind, and Jesus was in his heart. And you know what else? I said, what else? She says, he had a Bible that he took to work every day. And over lunch, he read that Bible. And so when I was hearing this, I'm going, wow, what can you say of human life that that's what you, the life you live? And so I told her, I said, you know, you don't have to worry about your father. He's right here with you. He lived with Christ his whole life. So you don't have to worry about him now. You're going to see him again in a new body. And all of a sudden, she sort of stopped crying, and she said, I will, won't I? I said, you sure will. And then I said, God's going to bless this man and take care of him. Because he spent his life with him. When I see people in the hospital, it's amazing to me. Just this past week, I prayed with 35 people. Some took it more than others, or you know, met more than others. But what I saw in some was a light. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. He comes to us and provides a light for those people who need. And it's amazing. I get a tremendous amount of satisfaction being able to be used by God to bring God into those groups. I think the ark to me is an ark for us in the future. It's our ark for righteousness. You know, in the Bible it says two places about Abraham. God considered him right because he accepted God. He believed God was twice in the Bible. And I would submit to you that as Abraham was right with God, we can be right. And if we remember Jesus, the King, he's also our ark to righteousness. It gives me great satisfaction now that I'm mostly retired, sitting on my back porch and having my coffee, saying good morning, Lord, and realizing that righteousness is mine forever, forever. That's the King that we have. He's more than a King. He's our Creator. He's our Savior. achieve. We have so many blessings. I know we have a lot of problems. We've got COVID's going to drive us all either drink or insane. But it is what it is. Fact, Jesus is going to get us through it. And I don't have any doubt at all. And we need to thank him for what he did for us, what he is for us. He's more than our king. He's all that we have, all that we need. And through him, we can have everlasting life with him. And that's a marvelous, marvelous thing to know. So again, I wish all of you a happy Thanksgiving. If you get to take, if by any chance you're going to I-75 and you see a parked encounter, this thing, it really confirms, and it not only confirms that it could be done, but it also argues about creation and the others, the theory that, you know, God didn't create and seven things. And it goes through the whole story of Christ and shows you this is real. This is not a joke. This is not a bathtub with a giraffe sticking out of the top. This is real. God's word said he did. I believe he did. What this thing will do was bring you to say, I still don't know how I did it. And I think, to me, that was a great, great experience. So, I wish you guys a great blessing and Thanksgiving, and as we look forward to God's birth, pray for preachers, missionaries, evangelists, and teachers who carry your forgiveness and love to the world. Fill their words and actions with compassion and kindness so that your truth will shine. Bless the ministry of Augustinian Lutheran School, Ramana, and St. Johannes Bavaria. We pray for Grace Mission, Shay Moy, Orphanage Haiti. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, you sent your Son Jesus to lead us into the way of peace. Direct the members of international alliances in choosing a non-violent path toward the future. Give them the humility and wisdom to make such decisions that benefit all. We pray for those who serve in the military, especially Sean Roche and Sequoia McClendon. God, in your mercy. God, you sent your Son Jesus to rule in all time and place. We pray for the friends of our congregation who are unable to join our worship in person and for all who are sick and suffering, especially Kathleen Dahl, Charlie Parks, William Hannon, Bob Keener, Susan and David Friend, Maureen Caldwell, April Kennedy, Andy and Jim Harvey, John Bennett, Sarah Lanier, Catherine Campbell, Terry Emden, Bill Tidwell, Marcus Lohner, Charlie Norman, Gary Larson, Kay Pendrati, Janet Kendrick, and family. Join their prayers with ours and unite them with us in the body of Christ. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless those celebrating birthdays: Bill Gates, Elaine Bell, A.K. Mislow.
Sorry.
Okay. Betty Hannett, Gwen Parks, and those celebrating baptism: Heather Lohner, those celebrating anniversary: Patrick and Heather McVeigh, Eddie and Harold Meeks, and expectant parents: Heather and Marcus Lohner. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift up all others we name in our hearts or on our lips. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our hope and strength, we entrust you to all for whom we pray. Remain us always, with us always, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for your word you made all things. You spoke light in the darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God, by your word you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts: freedom from captivity, water in the desert, a pathway home from exile, wisdom from life with you. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call to us witness. Forgive us through the cross. Life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God, rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith, increase our hope, deepen our love, and for the sake of a world in need, faithful to your word, God, draw near to all who call on you, through Jesus Christ our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever.
Amen.
Let us remember us, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us
Thank you.